Amen. Yes, it's good to be free, right? The enemy doesn't no longer has us as his prisoner. We are free indeed. Amen? Hallelujah. And Happy New Year to everyone. The Lord has blessed us once again and given us another opportunity to be servants for his glory in another year. Amen? Praise God. Good to see everyone this morning joining with us. And everyone joining with us online, thank you for being together with us, and Happy New Year, and pray the Lord prospers everyone, spiritually, most of all, in relationship with him and with others, amen? And whatever else fringe benefits come along with that, hallelujah. Yes, what a wonderful, loving God we serve, hallelujah. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, loving God, we can never run out of praises unto your holy name, dear Lord, for you never run out in the ways you bless us so mightily, dear mighty Lord. And we give you glory and honor, dear mighty
thank
Father.
You, Jesus.
And we thank you for once again this new year, dear Lord, and starting off this new year in worship and praise unto your holy name in your house. And dear Father, Lord, we seek your anointing upon this service and your protective hand upon those that are still making their way upon the road that they arrive safely. We ask you for your continued anointing. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Let's praise the Lord.
Glory, glory, hallelujah. Since I lay my burdens down, glory, glory, hallelujah. Since I
where?
Down by the riverside.
Thank you, Jesus. You may be seated.
I will call upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. I will call upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. So shall I.
The beginning.
Well, I will call upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. I will call upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. Shall I be saved? So shall I be saved from my enemy.
The Lord thy God,
in the midst of thee,
is my
For the challenges you are before us, Lord Father, you are with us, and we thank you. We thank you for saving our souls, Lord, and we thank you. We look forward for the coming, Lord, of your Son, Jesus. We glorify you. We thank you, Lord. We bless you, Lord. Let's sing that chorus.
Brought us this far, amen? He's brought us this far because of his grace. You know, you may be here this morning and you may be struggling. Maybe you're here this morning, wanted to throw that towel in, but God has brought us through this far, amen? And he's going to see us through as he saw us through 2021. He's going to see us through 2022. But blessed be our God, amen? Amen. You may be seated this morning. This morning, we want to go to prayer. We want to lift up these here on our prayer board, our prayer requests this morning. Once again, we want to lift up Sister Gwen and Sister B. Gallardi in prayer. Let's continue to keep them in prayer for healing, for strength. Also, let's continue to keep Brother Eddie in prayer. I believe he's been in the hospital since Monday I'm not sure if he's still in the hospital, but let's continue to keep Brother Eddie LaBoy in prayer. Sister Nancy Miyashiro needs a touch from the Lord. Let's continue to keep Sister Nancy in prayer. Sister Lena Mook, let's continue to keep her in prayer. Brother Marcy's in recovery. His surgery went well on this past Thursday, and so I believe they should be releasing him on Monday. So let's continue to keep Brother Marcy in prayer as he recovers from his knee surgery. Also, let's continue to keep George Chow in prayer. That's my dad's neighbor. He went in the hospital, came back out, and he went back in. So let's continue to keep George Chow in prayer. Dee and Carlin are not feeling well, so let's continue to keep them both in prayer. Benji needs a touch from the Lord. He's dealing with some health issues this morning, so let's continue to keep Benji in prayer. Also, had a note that Jem's mom passed away, so we want to keep Brother Jem in prayer and the family in prayer. Also, let's continue to keep Tammy in prayer. She needs a touch also from the Lord. Let's continue to keep her in prayer. Also, this morning we had a chance to pray for Navea. That's Sister Etta's or the Manumas, their niece, a 10-month-old child that's dealing with pneumonia. So let's continue to keep Navea in prayer. Let's continue to keep Trent, as usual, in prayer. Noel, Ali'i, and all of our unsaved loved ones. Amen. The altars are open. You may spend some time with the Lord. Maybe you're here this morning and you need the Lord. You need to make that recommitment to the Lord. God is faithful. We need to put our trust in Him. Amen? Amen. Let us look to the Lord in prayer. Father, we are truly blessed once again, for You are God. You are our Lord, our Savior. You are the King of kings and the Lord of lords. Father, we are so thankful, Lord God, that we serve an awesome God who hears our prayers and answers them according to Your perfect will. And Father, it's our responsibility, Lord God, through Your word, that we need to bring forth our prayers before You, Lord God. And Lord, we know, Lord, that You hear our prayers and that You would answer them according to Your perfect will. So this morning, Father, we lift up our prayers, we lift up our petitions before You, Father. Lord, we lift up, once again, we lift up Sister Gwen, we lift up Sister B, Lord God. Father, for both that need a touch from You, Lord God, we pray for Sister Gwen, Lord God, who's still recovering from her stroke, Father, Lord. We pray, Father, for complete healing in her body, Father, Lord. Touch her. Heal her, Lord God. In Jesus' name we pray. Father, for Sister B, Lord God, still trying to find out what's going on, Lord God. So, Lord, we pray, Father, Lord, that You would give the doctors wisdom and knowledge, Lord God, to bring forth what's going on through all these tests that she's been taking, Father, Lord. So we pray Your hand be upon her, Lord God. We pray, Father, Lord, that You continue to touch her and heal her, Lord God. In Jesus' name we pray. Father, we also pray for Brother Eddie, Lord God. Lord, wherever he may be in a hospital right now, or he may be at home, Father, resting, Father. We pray, Lord God, that You would just touch him, Father. Heal him, Lord God. In Jesus' name we pray. Father, Lord, we pray, Lord God, that You raise him up from that bed of affliction, Lord God, and that You would bring healing to him, Father, in Jesus' name. Father, we also pray for Sister Nancy, Lord God, and Sister Lena Mook, Lord, also need a touch from You, Father. We pray, Lord God, that You would just touch and heal him. Lord, we also pray, Lord God, for Brother Marcy, Lord God. We are so thankful, Lord, for that surgery, Lord God. Lord, he came out well as usual as we put our trust and faith in You, Lord God. But Lord, he still needs recovery, Lord God. He still needs to do rehab and therapy, Lord God. So Lord, we pray, Father, Lord, that You would just touch and heal him, Father, Lord. We pray for a speedy recovery as we commit him into Your hands, Lord God. Father, we also pray for George, Lord God. And Lord, we pray, Father, Lord, that You would just touch him, Father, wherever he may be. Father, but most of all, Lord God, we don't know his spiritual life. We don't know his relationship is with You or not, Lord God. So, Lord, we pray, Father, Lord, that if he doesn't know You as Lord and Savior, Lord, that he would give his life over to You, that he would look to You, Father, in Jesus' name. Father, we also pray for Dee and Carlin, Lord, not doing well this morning, still dealing with this cold. Father, we just pray, Lord God, that You remove whatever ailment that they're facing, Lord God, that You would just touch them and heal them. Father, also for Benji, Lord God, dealing with some health issues this morning. Father, we serve an awesome God, a mighty God who heals and touches. So, Lord, we pray, Father, Lord, that You would just touch our brother. Heal him, Lord God, in Jesus' name we pray. Father, we also pray for the Eleno family. We pray for Jem. We pray for their family, Lord God, dealing with the loss of their mom, of Jem's mom, Father. We pray, Lord God, that you would just comfort them and strengthen them during this time, Father. Lord, as they grieve the loss of their loved one, we pray, Father, for your strength, Lord God, as they continue to make the plans, Lord God, that's necessary, Father, for Jem's mother. Father, we pray, Lord God, that you just continue to bless the family, bless Jem in Jesus' name. Father, we also pray for Sister Tammy, Lord God, still dealing with some health issues also, Father, Lord, that you would just touch and heal her, Lord, wherever she may be, Father. And we put our trust and faith in you, Father, for your healing touch. Father, we also pray, Lord God, for Navea, Lord God, Father, for this little baby, Father, dealing with pneumonia, Father. We pray, Father, for your touch upon this little baby in Jesus' name. Father, we also pray for Trent. We pray for Lee. We pray for Noel once again, Lord God. We pray for our unsaved loved ones, Lord. You know our hearts. You know who's right with you, Lord God. So, Lord, we pray, Father, Lord, for our unsaved loved ones, Lord God, that some way, somehow, Lord God, you'll send people their way, Father, Lord, that they'll give their lives over to you. And we thank you, Lord God. And, Father, for those that are here that are at the altars, Lord God, laying their burdens before you, Lord God, Father, we pray, Lord God, that you would answer their prayers, that you would speak to their hearts, Lord, as they bring forth their burdens, their petitions, Father, Lord. Continue to bless them, Father, in Jesus' name. And Father, we are so thankful once again, Lord, that we can come into your house, Father, Lord, and we can gather as a church, Lord God, to lift up our prayers, our petitions before you, Lord God. And Lord, we pray, Father, Lord, that you would answer them according to your perfect will as we commit this into your hands, and we thank you, Lord. And this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God is good. Amen. Amen. All the time. Praise God.
Without him, I could do nothing.
True that is, without the Lord, where would we be? Amen. What a wonderful God. So you've been enjoying that rain? I look at it like this. A new year, so the Lord washed the islands, made it nice and clean to start off the new year. Just like you got up this morning, you took a shower, got all nice and clean, come to church. So God said, hey, new year, wash the island, make it nice and clean. I like that. Even though it was a little cold, but hey, I like clean. How about you? Amen? And only God can do that. Man can't make it rain for 3 days nicely. So praise the Lord for that, for the rain. Amen? And we always need rain. Okay? You can never have too much rain. Some people may disagree. But when you're real thirsty and there's no water, you'll wish you had floods. Well, praise the Lord anyway. And I welcome everyone this morning and this new year to start off together as a family in the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. And everyone that's joining with us online. And also, to start off the new year, can join with us Wednesday. I'll call the prayer. Come out together. We know prayer works, but you need people to be praying. And so come out and join us on Wednesday from 6:30 to 7:15. Bring your own prayer list, or can follow up on the screen, or whatever's on your heart to pray for our nation, our leaders, and families, and, you know, the list goes on. But come out and join with us, and we have a wonderful time in prayer. You know, it's a great time. It's not a burden. It's fun. I mean, I like it. I have a wonderful time in prayer. So join with us if you have time. Come out and spend whatever time you can together as we intercede on behalf of others. And also, this being the first Sunday of the month of the new year, it's Mission Sunday, and you have the opportunity, and we thank everyone for continually supporting missions. For there are many workers of the Lord that have gone forward to answer the Great Commission to take the gospel into all the world, but they need assistance and to help sustain them to keep going, so that souls may be saved. Amen. So we thank everyone who has been participating and helping out with our missions. Also, coming up on the 15th of this month, Adopt the Highway, and come out and join us. It's going to start from 8:30 a.m. in the morning until 12:30 p.m. And we want to help beautify our community by picking up. Have you seen, you're driving on the freeway or up and down Fort Weaver, and you're driving behind someone's truck or car or whatever, and have you ever seen stuff fly out the back, right? And have you ever seen anyone stop and go out and pick it up? No. So what's happening to the community? Well, thanks for faithful workers of the Lord, like from Ever Beach Assembly of God, who go out and participate to help clean up the community because of those who lack the desire to do it. So praise the Lord and come out if you have the time to join together and beautify our community. And at this time, I'd like to call up Sister Sharon.
Good morning, everyone. I'm just here to share some information on behalf of the Pokey family. For those that were wanting to come and support the family, Kalani Pokey's celebration of life will be held next Saturday at the Salvation Army Croc Center in Kapolei. The doors will be opened at 9 a.m. and then the program will start, or the memorial will start at 10 a.m. and then lunch to go will follow. So if you guys have any questions, Pastor and I will try to get those answers for you as quickly and as best as we can. All right? Okay. Amen.
And also now we can have available And thank you. I'm live. I was just only practicing. I forgot. yeah. But anyway, utilize today. We live in a time technology is advancing, and the church has taken advantage of that opportunity. By now we have a website, and you can utilize all the different features there, as well as one of the features as tithes and offerings and other charitable givings you would like to participate in. And for other things, you know, you can send emails, contacts, prayer requests, fill out certain forms, whatever. And it's wonderful. Amen? Because technology is moving forward no matter what. So it's good to tag along to some degree. Amen? And so at this time, let us lift up our hearts in prayers unto the Lord and giving thanks for allowing us to be able to give. Father in heaven, we honor you, dear mighty Lord, and we praise you. And we participate, dear Father Lord, through the gratitude of our hearts of how you've anointed us and blessed us and provided for each and every one of us, dear Lord, that we can give and participate with missions, dear Lord, and other ministries, dear Father God, and to help with furthering the gospel, dear mighty Lord. And we thank you, Lord, that we were able to give, dear mighty Lord, with cheerful hearts. And we ask your anointing and blessings upon these offerings, dear mighty Lord, and these tithes, dear mighty God, that you may use it and prosper it for your glory, that you continually be glorified. In the blessed name of Jesus, we ask and pray. Amen. Amen.
Who am I that you are mindful of me, that you hear me when I call? Is it true that you are thinking of me? Oh, how you love me.
Are you a friend of God?
Amen.
Amen. He should be a BFF or your best friend forever. He got to go between, he's supposed to be top priority. He got to go between your spouse. He's supposed to be the top, better than your children. He's supposed to be better than your parents. He's supposed to be the top. Amen. And then everything else falls into place. Some people get confused. They think they got to put their spouse first and children first. We need to put God first. Amen. Amen. You know, speaking of missionaries, you know, we had a chance to go and meet up with Denny and Debbie Seller from their all the way in Missouri right now, but you know, he's pastor or missionary Denny. Been working with the Latin America or the southern, you know, those places, Mexico, Peru, but he's doing a mighty work, him and Debbie Seller. But we had a chance to just to connect with them and just to meet up with them, and you know, they were only coming in for a couple of days from Christmas, so, and I think 4 or 5 days, so we couldn't squeeze them into our services because we had our end of the year service. But they send their love to you guys, and they want to thank all of you for faithfully giving to their ministry. Continue to keep them in prayer. They look like Brother Denny was saying that. Maybe in a couple of years they're going to retire from their call, so we want to continue to keep them in prayer. Also, a couple of other things. I just want to thank, you know, I just was looking at the people that were on stage and just people that was around this church, and I just want to thank those that have been attending 2 services to keep the service going, and you know, we do need volunteers and help during these 2 services, and some have been staying here for 2 services from the first service, and then been ministering and all the way to our 2nd service. So I just want to thank you guys for always being there. I'm truly grateful for the sacrifice you guys all made. And the last thing I want to also mention is that in our kitchen, right after service, you can go out in our kitchen area. You can browse. We have some things that that we received from Aloha Harvest. So it's there for you guys to take. So right after service, you can go and visit the kitchen. Amen? Amen. Amen. So this morning, we're going to continue in our series. Last month, we began a new series called The Imminent Return of Jesus Christ. And, you know, and during that time, we were talking about his return. We're talking about the rapture. So we're going to continue on in this series. And I believe we passed out a handout, several handouts. So if you guys haven't received one or you guys need one, if you can raise your hand, and our ushers will go and pass out those papers to you. But it's just a couple of handouts for those that are taking notes or using our church app. You go on our church app, you'll see those slides there, those pictures there, and you guys can use that as your notes, and you can email it to you and have that in your possession. But these are just a couple of handouts that we made, and it's just to help us to learn about the imminent return of our Lord. So let us look to the Lord in prayer. Father, once again, we just count it a joy. Lord, we just count it a blessing, Father, that we can come once again to sit before you, Lord God. And Father, we come to sit before you, to worship you, to honor you, to glorify you, Lord God, and also, Lord God, to hear your words that you're going to bring forth, Lord God. So, Lord, we ask, Lord, as your word goes forth, Lord God, that you would encourage and challenge and give the people hope, Lord God, that one day soon you will be coming. You will be coming for your church. And, Lord, until then, we got so much work to be done that we need to keep on going and keep on pushing forward for you. So, Lord, we ask that you bless this time, Lord God, as we look into your word and as we look at the imminent return of you, Lord God, that someday, one day soon, that you will come to receive your church to you. So, Lord, we ask that you bless this time. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. How many of you guys are excited for the Lord's return? Amen. That should give us hope. Amen. That should keep us going every single day is because the Lord can come back anytime, and we need to be ready. We need to be ready, working. We need to be waiting for his return, and that's what the past message was all about. And now this morning we're going to be looking specifically at the imminent return or the rapture of the church. And so this message last month, we looked at it and we looked at one of the greatest promises in Scripture for any believer. When they read that, it's a promise that that encourages us each and every day, and it's found in John chapter 14, verses 1 through 4. So if you have your Bibles with you this morning, turn with me to John chapter 14, verses 1, and we're going to read all the way through verse 4. But here it reads, Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. Another translation is many rooms. Another translation, many dwelling places. But here Jesus is reminding us that he is preparing a place for us. He says, for in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself. Now here Jesus is telling us, he's telling his disciples that he's preparing a place for us and that he will come again. And that's what we're looking for. That's our blessed hope. That's our hope that we hold on to each and every day, that God is going to come back for his children. And he says, when I come back again, I will receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And where I go, you know, and the way you know. I mean, what an awesome promise. Amen. Awesome promise. It's a promise that specifically the Lord made to his disciples, and we're considered his disciples. Amen. See, in context, he's talking to his disciples there, but out of context, he's talking to each and every disciple here. And, you know, back then, they were waiting for the coming of the Lord, and we're still waiting for the coming of the Lord. So what an awesome promise that the Lord is going to prepare a place for you and I, and that when everything is ready and is good to go, he will come back again, and he will get us. He will come back again so that we will be with him for always, and wherever he is, we're going to go with him. And so we know that God is sitting at the right hand of the Father. He's in heaven, and so He's going to come back, receive his church, and he's going to take us back to where he is. And this event that we're talking about, like I mentioned before, is the rapture of the church, the imminent return of Jesus Christ, the rapture of the church. This is where Jesus will fulfill his promise here in John chapter 14, that he's coming again to receive his children to himself. Now, last month we saw that the rapture and the second coming are two separate events, completely different events. And, and we passed out that handout. That's for you guys to keep. We won't go through it again this morning, but it's there for you. You guys can go and read and see and how different it is. And we're going to look through the God's timeline and see exactly when these events will occur. But when we look at the second coming of Christ, you know, we use it in a general sense, as I mentioned last time, is that we use it in a general sense that includes two phases, two stages, or two parts of this second coming. The first stage, or the first phase, is the rapture of the church, and the second phase is the actual second coming of the Lord, when the Lord will come with his church and he'll set foot on this earth. So it comes in stages or in phases, this second coming. And that's why we're going to look at this God's timeline, is that we're going to see when these phases are coming in. So if you look at God's timeline this morning, and then you look at your paper this morning, once again, we see the Old Testament in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. We see that the Old Testament, humanity comes into play when he created man. And then so, you know, we see from Genesis to Malachi, then we know that there's a period of silent years, 400 years of silent years, where God didn't speak to no prophets or anything, or didn't speak to his people. And then it's the beginning of the New Testament, where we read the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, where we read of the birth of Jesus Christ, or the life of Jesus Christ. We know that, you know, we believe in the birth of our Lord. We also believe in his sinless life. We believe in his miracles. We believe his death and his resurrection, and then his ascension into heaven. And now he's sitting at the right hand of the Father. And then we come to the church age. The church age, this is when the church was birthed. In Acts chapter 2, on the day of Pentecost, we see that the church, when the Holy Spirit came down and indwelled in his people, then the church was born. That's what we considered the church age, and this is where we're at right now. We're in the church age. How many of you guys ever gone to a shopping center or a mall, big shopping center or mall? Ala Moana now is real big, and you look at these big billboards, or not billboards, or big signs, Anytime when you're lost, you get directions, right? And then you look where, you know, all the stores are at. But remember where you always see this is where you're at, or you're here, or something on that particular screen or board. Well, this is where we're at right now. The church is at the church age, meaning that we're here. This is what we're in. We're living in now. We're living in the church age. And so the next upcoming event is the rapture of the church. The next event on God's prophetic calendar is the rapture of the church. This is the next event that we're all looking forward to. This is when God is going to receive his church. This is when chapter 14 will be fulfilled, when God will receive his church to himself. And so this is what we're waiting for, is the imminent return of Jesus Christ. Imminent means it can happen at any time, or it's about to happen. It can happen very soon. That's what imminent means. It means it can happen at any time. You know, when you listen to, the weather reports and you see hurricanes coming, big rains coming, they give you warnings. First, it's a watch. You got to be watchful and stuff. And then now you get warnings as the hurricane or as the storm gets closer, you turn into warnings. Why? Because now they start announcing there's imminent danger coming. You know, if the storm hits the islands, you know, there's imminent danger. That's the same thing as we're talking about, that it can happen anytime now. It can happen very soon. And this is what imminent means. It means that God can come back at any time. Amen. Would it be awesome that God comes back while we're in service? I mean, that would be so great. You know, when we're praising God, we're glorifying him, we're worshiping him, and he just raptures up his church. He just snatches up his church. I mean, what a blessing that would be. You know, we're ready to receive or be received by the Lord. But we see here that the imminent return of Jesus Christ is the rapture of the church. We believe in the pre-tribulation view, as I mentioned before. There's different views, and there's many other views, but the three main views are the pre-trib, mid-trib view, or the post-trib view. Now, also, some Christians believe that there's no tribulation, I mean, there's no rapture, but we believe in the pre-trib, or that the Lord will remove his church from this earth before the wrath of God is going to be poured out of this church. We believe that God will remove his church. You know, it says in scripture, and we're going to be looking at these scriptures probably next week, and specifically talks about how God is going to remove, why God is going to remove, because he doesn't want us to go through that. You know, he wants to take us out before, he pours out his wrath upon this earth. Now, you got to realize that we are considered the bride of Christ. Amen. We're considered the bride of Christ. Now, imagine, as a husband, I wouldn't want to put my wife, the bride, my wife, through any harm. I want to protect her as best as I can. And imagine how the Lord feels. He doesn't want us to go through the tribulation and go through all these things that he's going to pour out upon the earth. He wants to protect us. He wants to get us out of there. And that's why we so truly believe in the pre-trib view, because we also read in scripture that of his imminent return. And, you know, if it's a mid-trib view that you think of, or a post-trib, that means that you're going to know when the Lord is coming. It's not going to be sudden. It's not going to be imminent. You're going to figure out when the Lord is coming. But we believe in the pre-trib view, because we know that the Lord will pull us out, or get us out of this world, before he pours out the wrath upon this earth. But we believe in his imminent return. Once again, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 16 through 17, we'll be sharing this scripture throughout this message, because this scripture clearly defines of the rapture, or the imminent return of our Lord. But it says, "For the Lord himself will descend." He will descend from heaven with a shout. Now, you got to remember that when the Lord, back in Acts chapter 1, the Lord ascended into heaven. I mean, if you guys look at the escalators. When we go down, we're descending. When we're going up, we're ascending. But the Lord ascended into heaven in Acts chapter 1, as we read in Scripture. But this time, we read in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 16 through 17, that the Lord will descend. He will come down from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with a trumpet call of God. And the dead in Christ shall rise first. Now the dead, God has it all in proper order. The dead will be reunited with their bodies. Their physical bodies were left here on earth. Some may be cremated. Some may be buried underneath the ground. But their physical body will be reunited with their soul. And we see here that the dead in Christ will rise first. I don't know how he's going to do it. You know, I don't know, some people's ashes are in the ocean, but God is going to do it. We believe that God is going to do something miraculous. And so we read in Scripture, and whatever he says, we believe. So the dead in Christ will rise first, then those who are alive and remain. Who's alive? Hopefully we're all alive right now. We're not falling asleep or anything. But we who are alive and well, we who are living at that time, shall be caught up. And this is where we got the word rapture, caught up. And we're going to look at more into this word caught up or rapture. But those that are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet where? Where are we going to meet the Lord? In the air. Amen. We're going to meet the Lord in the air. This time he's not going to be coming down on earth and touching the earth. He will be meeting up with the Lord in the air. And this is what this first stage of the second coming is. This is what the rapture is, that we're going to meet the Lord up in the air. Jesus will not set foot on this earth. His church will be caught up to him to meet him up in the air. And that very moment, we who are alive and well will be instantly changed. This is a believer-only event. Like I mentioned before, those that have received Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior will know about this event. We're going to be caught up. We'll be raptured. And it's going to only be for the believers. The Lord will remove us, will snatch us up as an act of deliverance, and remove us from this coming judgment here on earth. For us believers, it's going to be a time of joy. It's going to be a time of, this is when our hope will be fulfilled. Our blessed hope will be fulfilled. Now, the next event after that in heaven, the born-again believers, those that have given their life to the Lord, will come before the Lord at the judgment seat of Christ. Last month, we kind of briefly looked at the judgment seat of Christ. Every born-again believer and every born-again Christian will stand before God and give an account on his life or his or her life that we lived here on earth. When we stand at the judgment seat of Christ, we'll be judged for being who we're supposed to be as disciples of Jesus Christ. It's a time that the Lord is going to judge us for what we have done with his son. And we're going to receive rewards at this time. And all the things that we have done for the Lord will be brought forth. And we're going to be judged. We're going to be accountable for that. We all will stand before God one day and give an account of what we did with his son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. It will be a time where the Lord is going to bring into question what we did with our time, what we did with our talent, what we did with our resources, our treasures in this Christian life. I mean, how we got Jesus out? How did we do for Jesus? What did we do for our Lord? I mean, that's the question I need to ask you guys this morning, is what have you done with Jesus? What kind of things have you done for the Lord? Are you still ministering to the people on the Lord's behalf? Are we still ministering? Are we still trying to reach out to people? Are we still living the life the Lord has called us to live, to minister to the people? Are we ministering to people? Are we still shining our light for the Lord? Are we still living the way that the Lord has called us to live? Because we know that our lives reflect Jesus Christ, amen? And we are witness. People look at our lives and, people get saved. People see the difference in our lives and people ask questions. How come so-and-so changed? That's a perfect tool to witness to those that are lost and dying. So are we still living the life that the Lord has called us to live? Are still people seeing Jesus in us? What about witnessing? Are we witnessing for him? Are we going out there and sharing the gospel with this lost and dying community? This community, is dark. I mean, we go out, we walk the streets, we go out and go and visit the homeless, we go out and visit the people. You see that people have no clue, or they don't even want to bother with the Lord. And we're, our responsibility as believers, as disciples, is to go out and is to shine our light and to reach the lost. So we need to always be reminded or always remember that we need to be witnessing for God. We need to go out and start winning people for Jesus Christ. So what have you done for the Lord? And that's what the Lord wants us to realize, is that we're going to stand accountable, that we're going to have times in our lives that we need to speak out, to stand for the truth, to share the gospel with others. But we're going to stand before God at this judgment seat of Christ. Then the next event, as we're still here, is the marriage supper of the Lamb. Kind of look a little bit last week on it. But we're going to be celebrating. How many of you guys ever went to a big wedding celebration? Amen. This one is going to be unreal. It's going to be unreal. I mean, we read in scripture of this event, but here in Revelation chapter 19 speaks specifically of this event, the marriage supper of the Lamb. In verses 7 through 8, it tells us, "Let us rejoice and be glad and give the glory to him. For the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his bride has made herself ready." How many of you guys remember that song? Amen. Amen. And it says in verse 8, "It was given to her to clothe herself in fine linen, bright and clean. And the fine linen is the righteous acts of the saints." It's going to be a time that we're going to be celebrating with the Lord. The Lord is going to receive us, and we're going to be sitting, or we're going to be here at the marriage supper of the Lamb. But here we see that, you know, throughout scriptures, we and many occasions, that the church is compared to a bride, the bride of Christ. Now, you know, when I first got saved, you know, it was something hard for a man to accept, you know, to accept that that you're a bride. I mean, the first thing I was thinking, I'm not a bride, but when you look at scripture and when you see that you are considered the bride of Christ, if you're a man just like me, you guys got to man up and say, "I'm a bride, Lord. I'm a bride. No matter what, you know, I'm a bride. I'm a bride, and he's the groom." But we see here that, you know, the bride of Christ is the church, and the groom is Jesus Christ. So one day there will be a heavenly wedding where we will be presented to the groom, who is Jesus Christ, our Lord. And so in spite of just that one mention in Revelation chapter 19, about the marriage supper of the Lamb, throughout scripture we see throughout scripture that this describes this great event. So it's not hard to, you know, understand and to know the most wonderful wedding reception ever planned by our Lord. And so in the marriage supper of the Lamb is going to be a great, great celebration. I mean, just imagine going to this celebration where you're going to see all your loved ones, where you're going to see people that you've read in the Bible. But this is going to be a great wedding feast. It's going to be where we're going to be with our bridegroom, who is Jesus Christ, our Lord. And then this is where we left off last week, is the tribulation. The next event after that would be the tribulation. Well, at this time, we're going to be probably at the same time as the church is raptured up. We're going to be at the judgment seat of Christ, the marriage supper of the Lamb. But here, back on earth, the tribulation time is going to begin. Here, the tribulation, as we are caught up back on earth, people are going to deal with the seven-year tribulation. The first 3.5 years are called the peaceful years, as I mentioned last week. I don't think it's going to be peaceful. Why? The first thing is that we know the world we live in, already it's chaos. You look around the world we live in right now, it's chaos. It's hectic. It's going, I mean, it's real bad. But imagine when the Christian or the church is raptured up. Imagine all those people being removed from this earth. I don't know how many Christians we have here on earth, maybe 500 million or something. I don't know. I don't know how much Christians, but imagine all those Christians being raptured up, being taken away from this earth. Imagine the chaos that's going to happen. People are going to kind of go ballistic. They're going to just go haywire because they don't know what's going on. Some people are going to go right back to the Bible and start figuring out what had happened to the church. But it's not going to really be a time of peace. It's going to be a time of chaos. It's going to be a time where they're going to be looking for someone to bring this peace to this earth. And this is when the Antichrist will come onto the scene, the man of lawlessness, the man of sin, the man doomed to destruction. He will emerge onto the scene. Now, the word anti, as we saw last time, means against, but it also means instead of. You see, this Antichrist will come against Christ, everything that God has. He's going to come against that. He will be a counterfeit. People are going to hail him as the Messiah, but he's going to be a fake Christ, an imitation Christ. How many of you guys ever ate imitation crab? Yeah, I like it by itself. But how many of you guys ever ate regular crab? Yeah. Big difference, right? Big difference. You try to dip imitation crab in butter. It ain't the same. You can tell it's fake. But, you know, and that's what this imitation Christ is going to come out. It's going to be a fake imitation, a counterfeit Christ. He's going to come against Christ, and he's going to be like a fake Christ, an imitation. And people will believe him and hail him as Messiah. Some have tried to speculate who this person is. You know, like I mentioned before, we're not going to know because we'll be up in heaven. We'll be rejoicing with the Lord. But the people down here, you're going to see who this Antichrist is going to be. You know, but we know from Scripture that this Antichrist will not come on onto the scene until the church is removed from this earth. As we saw last time, we know that there's this restrainer that's holding this man of lawlessness back. And you can read it all in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. Very wonderful chapter. Talks all about the Antichrist. But he will not be revealed until the church is removed. You see, when the Holy Spirit's work is done within the church and he ushers us up into the rapture, this is when the Holy Spirit will step aside and the Antichrist will be revealed. The Holy Spirit's work through the church is that restraining power, is that the one that's restraining this evil one. When the church is removed, then the Antichrist will be revealed. And so when we look at the Antichrist, it also describes the Antichrist as the beast, and this is where we left off last time. He comes onto the scene, and he's not going to even come looking like a beast. He's going to be a man. He's going to emerge onto the scene as a man of intelligence. He's going to be a man with charisma. He's going to be a man that's engaging, that's charming. I mean, people are going to be drawn to him, to this person. You know, some say, you know, he's coming out from the European area, but this guy is going to come onto the scene, and he's going to be all this. He's going to be so brilliant that people are going to be drawn to this man. You see, this coming world leader, this coming world leader that we're talking about, the Antichrist, will come at a time where economically it's going to be difficult, during this time. And not only that, there'll be wars in different parts of the world, and through his brilliant political moves that he's going to be doing, along with his charisma, with his charms, his intelligence, he'll be able to do what no one has ever done before. He will bring economic stability to this world, this world's monetary system, and also he will bring peace to this world. This man will be a man of peace. He will bring global peace. He will get rid of all the world with terrorism. He'll be so successful that he'll be held as the greatest peacemaker that ever lived. And by establishing this peace, he would deceive many. I mean, many people would be drawn to this man. Many people would be drawn to this person. And, people would be drawn to him because he's going to bring peace to this earth. He will also convince and persuade the Jewish nation and the Arab nation to sign a peace treaty, paving the way for the construction of the long-awaited temple at the Temple Mount in Jerusalem. And he will also help the Jewish people build their temple. But behind all this smartness and friendliness and peacefulness, behind this charismatic man will be the most evil man who ever walked on this face of this earth. His true identity, his true colors will come will come out after the three and a half years is complete, and at the midpoint of the tribulation period, the Antichrist will break his covenant with Israel. He will then go and desecrate the temple. He'll go into the temple. He'll set up an image of himself in there, and he will declare himself as God, as we see in Scripture called the abomination of desolation. This is where he's going to set up himself an image of himself, and he's going to declare himself God, and people will have to worship him and honor him. And this is where we see in Daniel chapter 12, verse 11, about the abomination of desolation. It says, from the time that the regular sacrifice is abolished and the abomination of desolation is set up, there will be 1,290 days. Now, when you count that into years, that's 3.5 years. So that 3.5 years, the mid part of it, this man of lawlessness will be there, and this is where they will experience the abomination of desolation. Also, it says in Matthew chapter 24, verse 15, it says, therefore, when you see the abomination of desolation, which was spoken of through Daniel the prophet, standing in the holy place, let the reader understand. So we need to understand when we read those scriptures is that the first three and a half years, you know, it's going to be a time where, you know, people are going to look for this man. And so when this man comes onto the scene, he's going to have this Antichrist is going to be, you know, bringing peace. He's going to be doing all these things to bring the people together. But after that, the midpoint is when everything is going to turn south. Everything is going to turn for the worse. This is when he's going to set up his image, and he's going to want people to worship him and honor him. And so we see here, after the abomination of desolation, there will be 3.5 years of God's wrath that's going to be poured out on this earth. And then at the end of the 3.5 years, Christ will come back with his church. And this is the next, this next one as we're going to look at is the second coming, the actual second coming of Jesus Christ. This is when Jesus Christ will come down with his church, and we will come down, and this is where Christ will set foot on this earth. The second coming, or the revelation of Christ, is when Christ will return to this earth. He will come to this earth. He'll stand upon it, revealing himself to all people. This is where every eye will see who Jesus Christ is. Now, like I mentioned before, you know, this is not like the first phase. The first phase is when Jesus Christ will not step foot on this earth. This is when he's going to rapture the church. But the second phase, or the second part of the second coming, this is when he actually comes to this earth with his saints. And this is where we're going to be with him. Amen? Something that we're going to look forward to. I'm looking forward to that day when we're following the Lord, when we're with him as he comes back to this church. In Jude chapter 14, we read, see, the Lord is coming with thousands upon thousands of his holy ones. How many of you know we're the holy ones? When we give our lives to the Lord, guess what? We're set apart. We're holy. We're consecrated. We're set apart. And so we're considered holy. We're holy because of our relationship with the Lord. And we'll be with God. The thousands upon thousands of holy ones will be with him. And that's us. We're coming back with the Lord. You can also find another description in Revelation chapter 19, verse 11 through 15, where it reads that we're going to be dressed in fine linen and riding on white horses. Here it reads, then I saw heaven open, and a white horse was standing there. Its rider was named Faithful and True, for he judges fairly and wages a righteous war. His eyes were like flames of fire. On his head were many crowns, and a name was written on him that no one understood except himself. He wore a robe dipped in blood, and his title was the Word of God. The armies of heaven. How many of you guys know we're the armies of heaven? Amen. The armies of heaven, dressed in fine and pure white linen, followed him on white horses. From his mouth came a sharp sword to strike down the nations. He would rule with them with an iron rod. He would release the fierce wrath of God, the Almighty, like juice flowing from a wine press. How many of you guys ever rode a horse? Amen. Some of you guys had. I think the closest I got was the 58th State Fair, those carousels or maybe that E.K. Fernandez one that go up and down the quarter, those quarter rides, but that's the closest I got for riding a horse. But we're going to be riding on horses, amen? Riding on horses, and we'll be wearing fine white linen. But we see here, you know, when we come back with Jesus, he will come and he will judge, he'll be judge and he'll be ruler. He'll stand on the Mount of Olives. In Zechariah chapter 14, verse 4, it says, on that day, his feet will stand on the Mount of Olives, east of Jerusalem, and the Mount of Olives will split into two from east to west, forming a great valley with half of the mountains moving north and half moving south. You know, with all this technology nowadays, you know, many years back when they started to develop these technology and so forth, they started to find out where these fault lines are at. You know, what's so amazing is that, you know, they discovered that there's a big fault line that runs from east to west, as just how it predicted, how it says in Zechariah chapter 14, verse 4. So, you know, God is good. It just amazed me that, you know, how God is putting all of these things into place and makes us realize it should encourage us or get us happy or get us joyful that, you know, all these things that you read in Scripture are coming to pass. And so we see, you know, when the Lord comes, he's going to stand on the Mount of Olives. And, you know, we see that there's going to be a split from east to west. And so when we look at that, we look at the next thing that's going to happen on the God's prophetic calendar or God's timeline is the Battle of Armageddon. The Battle of Armageddon. This is the battle that ends all battle. This is the battle that's after the seven-year tribulation. It's going to be concluded with the Battle of Armageddon. It's going to be the war to end all wars. That's going to be fought in the Middle East in a valley called Megiddo. Now, down through history and as we read through Scripture, many battles have waged in this place called Megiddo. It's where Gideon defeated the Midianites. It's where Deborah and Barak defeated the Canaanites. This is where King Saul was killed in the Valley of Megiddo in a battle with the Philistines. But in this battle, as we know, as we read in Scripture, it's going to be a battle, a one-sided battle. No death in Christ's army. We don't do no fighting. We are there to watch everything unfold with the Lord going to destroy. He's going to overthrow the Antichrist, as it says in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. You guys got to read that chapter. Very good chapter, and explains what the Lord is going to do during that time. We read there that Jesus will slay him with the breath of his mouth and destroy him by his splendor of his coming. He will overthrow the Antichrist and the rest of his evil forces. He will overthrow the false prophet and also and so forth. He will destroy them by his word and by the brightness of his presence. I mean, aren't you glad you're on the winning side this morning? Aren't you glad that we serve God and that we're going to be on that winning side? We're not going to be on that other side. Praise God. You know, something that we got to look forward to, that it should encourage us. But at this time, you know, after the Battle of Armageddon, Satan will be chained. He'll be thrown into the bottomless pit. Though he commanded, you know, his vast networks of demonic power, and he ruled over principalities and spiritual forces, Satan will be bound. He'll be cast down for 1,000 years. Now, Satan won't be thrown into the lake of fire at this time. He will be, in essence, be placed in this holding area until God finally settles his case forever. But Satan, also known as Lucifer, we know him as our adversary. We know him as our tempter. We know him as the devil himself, who once wanted God's throne, who wanted to be worshipped instead of being a worshiper. He will be bound for 1,000, imprisoned for 1,000 years. Then the wicked, those who have rejected Christ, those that didn't commit their life to the Lord, will be judged and thrown into the fiery furnace at this time. And then begins the earthly rule of Jesus, known as the millennium or the millennium reign of Jesus Christ. Is that our next one on our timeline? The millennial reign, or a 1,000-year reign of Jesus Christ. Jesus will come physically to this earth. He will reveal himself. He will present his saints. He will judge his enemies at the Battle of Armageddon and begin his earthly rule, known as the millennium. At this time, we who have come with him on horses, the church, Those that came with him will also be ruling with Christ during this millennial period. Also, you got to remember, not everyone will be wiped out during this battle of Armageddon. The world still will be populated with survivors of the tribulation period. There will be people with normal earthly bodies who have survived this tribulation period. And at this time, everyone will come under the rule and reign of Jesus Christ. These survivors will have children, will have grandchildren, great-grandchildren, as the 1,000 years passes. But here, Jesus will rule. He will establish his kingdom here on earth for 1,000 years. He'll establish himself as king in Jerusalem, sitting at the throne of David. The Bible talks about the conditions of this millennial reign as perfect, as a perfect environment, both physically and spiritually. It's a time where you're going to see a time of peace, no more wars, no more conflicts, no more terrorism, no more nuclear programs, no more nothing like that. No military will be here. Not only that, even the animal kingdom, that's something that amazes me, right? When I read that scripture, is that even the animal kingdom will have peace. We read in scripture that the animals will be completely tame and docile. The wolves will dwell with the lamb. The leopards will dwell with the goats. The cow and the bears will graze together. I mean, it will be a time of perfect peace because the Prince of Peace will be ruling this earth. Amen? It's a time of perfect peace. But at the end of the millennial reign, at the end of the millennial reign, Satan will be released from his captivity for a short period of time. It will be the descendants of those that survived the tribulation period who will participate in that final rebellion. So, Satan will gather them up once and for all and have that final rebellion against God. I mean, this kind of goes to show you that even in a perfect environment, even just by living with Jesus for 1,000 years, people with sinful heart will still make the wrong choices. See, the Bible is so true when it talks about the heart. The heart is so deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Even after 1,000 years of Jesus and the best time this world has seen since the Garden of Eden, people are going to rebel against Jesus Christ. And so after the final rebellion, Satan will be cast into the lake of fire. And also at this time, the great white throne of judgment will take place. And this is where those who have rejected Christ, those who have didn't put their faith in Jesus Christ, will be raised and judged according to their works. The Bible teaches that there are two deaths, as we know in Scripture, one physical and the other spiritual death. Jesus warned that we are to fear the second death more than the first. Why? Because the second death is being eternally separated from God. That's what hell is being eternally separated from Jesus. See, Jesus indicated that the death of your body is nothing compared to everlasting banishment of a soul from God. And so the great white throne of judgment is where every man and woman who has not put their faith in Jesus Christ will have to stand before God, and they will know why he or she is facing this judgment. We also got to remember that God is no respecter of person. We got to remember that he doesn't care if you're big or small in this world. He don't care if this individual was a king, if this individual was a queen, if this individual was a prince or princess, or maybe a politician, maybe a billionaire or a president. He doesn't care. If you don't put your trust in Jesus Christ, if you don't put your faith in him, you will be judged at the great white throne of judgment. And so after that, these people who will be cast into the lake of fire, the everlasting punishment, the second death, as we saw, because they didn't receive Jesus Christ into their hearts, and their names are not found in the Lamb's Book of Life. Aren't you glad our names are found in the Lamb's Book of Life? Amen. That should encourage us, that our names are personally written in there in the Lamb's Book of Life. And that should encourage us to keep on pushing forward, amen, that our names are there and that we don't want ever our names to be taken out of there. But our names are there in the Lamb's Book of Life. We won't face spiritual separation. We won't face internal separation from God. We will be with him for all eternity. And the last thing is on this God's timeline is the new heavens and the new earth. Heaven and earth will pass away. The old heaven and earth will pass away. And then the new, it will be replaced by the new heavens and new earth. The new earth will be the eternal dwelling place of all believers, and we will be with our Lord for all eternity. The new earth will be free from sin, free from evil, free from sickness, free from death. It will be as God originally intended this world to be. On this new earth will be the new Jerusalem, as we read in Scripture. The new Jerusalem is already exists in heaven and will come down to earth. And this new city is a city that Abraham and his descendants were all looking forward to. And this is the same city. Hopefully that's the Lord coming. Hopefully. Amen. But, you know, the new heavens and new earth will come down, and this same city is a city with where every believer should be looking forward to. This is where we're going to be dwelling with our Lord forever and ever. I mean, God has made this new heaven, this new earth as the best, top notch, the very best. God reserved the very, very best for his people. Amen. And so we see here, and we can see it all in Revelation chapter 21, about the new heavens and new earth. But we see that God's timeline is very accurate, and we've been, you know, we can study Scripture, and we can see that now we're in a church age and we're ready for the coming of the Lord. But speaking about the judgment seat of Christ, let's go back to the judgment seat of Christ and the great white throne of judgment, and we'll end here this morning. Once again, just like the rapture and the second coming, two separate events, two completely different events. Same with the judgment seat of Christ, same with the great white throne of judgment, is two separate events, two separate groups of people that's going to be judged at this time. If you look at your chart this morning, the judgment seat of Christ, who will be the judge at the judgment seat of Christ will be Jesus Christ. At the great white throne of judgment will be Jesus Christ himself also. Who will be judged at this time? At the judgment seat of Christ will be the believers. Those that have received Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior will be judged at that time. The great white throne of judgment, unbelievers will be judged at that time. When will this occur? Once again, the judgment seat of Christ will occur after the rapture, during the tribulation period. The judgment seat of Christ, or the great white throne of judgment, will be after the millennium, before the lake of fire. What is the purpose? Is to reward those who receive Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. The great white throne of judgment is to judge those who rejected Christ. And the last thing is, what will be the results? Any good works done for the Lord while on earth will be rewarded. At the great white throne of judgment, all who rejected Christ will be thrown into the lake of fire, eternally separated from God. Completely two separate events. We need to be on the judgment seat of Christ, amen? The Bema seat of Christ. We should be there. That's why we need to continue on loving on the Lord, serving God the best that we can. We want to make sure that we make it into heaven. But this morning, as I close this morning, as I welcome our worship team this morning, next week we're going to be looking specifically at the rapture of the church, the imminent return of Jesus Christ. First two messages were basically an introduction onto what we're going to really looking forward to, or what we're going to put our eyes on and study for a couple weeks, is the return of our Lord, or the imminent return of Jesus Christ. But as we look at 2022, you know, we just came out of 2021. Always remember, as we continue on walking with the Lord in 2022, always be mindful that the Lord can come at any time, and that we need to be ready. We need to be ready for his coming. I can't wait, you know, for the Lord to come, you know, and that's our prayer many times, is come, Lord Jesus, come. But we know that God's heart is to save this world, and that he wants as much people to be saved. Now, we know as believers that, you know, this road that we walk on is very narrow, as we read in Scripture, and the road that leads to destruction is very wide. So we know that many will not receive Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, but we need to do our part. We need to make sure that the people have that ability or have that chance to receive our Lord into their hearts. So we got our work cut out this year. You know, we need to be about our Father's business. We need to continue on reaching our community. We're just one of many lighthouses throughout our community, but If you look at our community, it's very dark, but we gotta make sure that, you know, we make sure that we shine Jesus Christ out there in this darkened community, amen? So as we begin this 2022, I encourage you to hang on to the Lord. God is coming soon, he's coming very soon, and we need to be ready for his coming, amen? Amen. Let us rise as we, once again, we want to close this message with prayer. Father, once again, we count it a joy, Lord God. We count it a blessing, Father, Lord, that we can come into your house to read your word, Father, Lord, to see what you have in store for us. And Father, through your word, we know that you are coming. You are coming soon. And so, Lord, this morning we ask, Lord God, we know you know our hearts. Our hearts is that you come now, Lord God, that you would come now. Take us out of this world that's very evil and stuff. But Lord, we know your heart too is that you want many people to be saved. So Lord, we ask, Lord God, that your perfect will be done, Lord. If it is today, come, Lord Jesus, come. Praise God. If it's tomorrow, if it's next week, if it's a couple months or a couple years, we know that your timing is so perfect. But until then, we got our work cut out, and we want to be the best that we can, and we want to wait for your return. So until then, Lord God, encourage us, challenge us, strengthen us each and every day to keep on moving forward for you. And this we pray in Jesus' name, and we thank you, Lord. Amen, amen.
Let's sing that song without him. Without him, I could do nothing. Without him, I truly fail. Without him, I would be drifting like a ship. Verse 2.
Today is the day of salvation, amen. I mean, you read that, or you see that the commercial, I think it's American Express, don't leave home without it. Well, you know what, don't leave this earth without Jesus Christ, amen. If you don't know him this morning, the ministers will be here right after service. We'd love to introduce you to Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. If you're joining us via live stream, you can email us at the church, call the church office. We'd love to introduce you to Jesus Christ. But we have our work cut out, amen. This year 2022, yeah, it's not gonna be easy, but it's gonna be a time where we can share the love of Jesus with people, amen. So let us continue to do that each and every day. Let us look to the Lord and pray. Father, we are truly blessed once again, Lord. Lord, let us be that shining light for you. Let us be the salt and that light, Lord, that you've called us to be, Father. Let us be that shining light out of this darkened world, Lord God, to share the gospel, to share the good news of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Father, it's our responsibility, it's our duty, it's your command that you've commanded us to go out to preach the gospel. So, Lord, we ask that, Lord, that you give us opportunities each and every day to to share about you. But until then, Lord God, we thank you, Lord God, for this time, Lord God, that we can meet and we can worship you and honor you, Father, in our services. Father, we ask that you, Lord, as we make our way home this morning, that you would bless us with traveling mercies, Lord God. Bless us, Lord God, as we make our way home, Father, Lord. Keep us out of this stormy weather, Lord God, as we give you all the praise, honor, and glory. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you all.